Hello everyone, this is Carlo Grant, again speaking from the Academy of Meran, Merano. This is the fourth and last lecture of this series, Music Explains Itself. It is an introductory series, and it has been produced under the auspices also of Off the Hook Arts Festival. So we are trying to explain music without simplifying it. So without resorting to easy explanations, easy comparisons, although many comparisons, especially in this lecture, will take place and have taken place. These comparisons do not have the aim of providing a translation of music into a more obvious object of experience. Nor do they have the aim of finding a meaning that we recognize as such in other domains of life experience. We want music to be understood as music on its own terms, and that is the motto, to understand music on its own terms, musically, just like the way a musician listens to music, recognizing all those patterns, procedures that he or she works on during the educational self-development, musical educational process. So today's lecture will focus on, and it is very introductory, on style. What is a musical style? Also in reference to historicism and taste. And these two concepts can really conflict with one another, because when we speak about classical music, we do not define classical music as something that belongs in the real timeline of classicism or neoclassicism. Classical music, it can be anything written today, even tomorrow, as long as it belongs in some way to that flow, to that line of development that we call classical music, because it developed somehow with a sometimes rather logical chain of events. And that is where historicism plays an important role. And the fruition of classical music, we tend to think, is something rather different from commercial music, even though we have other types of music, for example, jazz music, that we cannot really call simply commercial, but that we should say they satisfy slightly different aesthetics, although jazz and classical music most often intertwine and interact. So let's say the border is rather thin sometimes. And the more we try to explain the difference between classical music and non-classical music, the more complicated it gets. But now we speak about style as language. And a lot of comparisons will help us define style and how it changes in history. This term, history, is most important. When we pay our attention to a work of art, we cannot avoid placing that work of art in a history line, into a timeline, according to the time and place in which this work of art was created, our judgment, taste, fruition acts with variable parameters of judgment that are somehow connected to this, to how and when that work was created. So I would pinpoint two terms, state of the art. Curiously, state of the art may sound very artistic, but it could also sound and be very technological. State of the art, it is. Here's the definition. Belonging or relating to the most recent stage of technological development. Having or using the latest techniques or equipment. What are the techniques or equipment in classical music? The composer wrote mostly with a pencil, a pen, and the equipment is, of course, the development and mastery of techniques here in the brain, in the inner ear, in how we have seen these sonic structures have been developed in the space, the metaphor of space and sound that makes up music, the organization of these sonic events in time. So that is the technique. We have seen how a piece by a simple bass line becomes a choral prelude by Bach. So state of the art can mean two different things, actually. One, the technological development and how it satisfies also laws of physics, function, especially the function of a technique, state of the art. We cannot ignore the state of the art of in medicine, in science. We cannot just go back and ignore what science has to offer when we are to apply it. When we speak about art, pure art, I don't mean just visual art, but art in general, also performing arts, the state of the art is, yes, some people say also technology, use this term, it's really not a form of progress. We shouldn't use the term development and evolution in a very technological way. Evolution, in fact, perhaps the Darwinian idea of evolution, fittest, not best, is more, pardon the alliteration, is more fitting. It is really what fits the moment, the time, what has happened before, and why it is this change in the application technique, change of technique itself, of its own grammar, not much of it, but perhaps its own syntax, and we have seen dissonances and consonances, why this change is necessary, why most composers, in our case, embrace this change. And of course, another term that is most fitting is the spirit, knowledge, mind, not only taste. There is a collectiveness, collective unconscious. It can be rather conscious, actually. It's just zeitgeist. It is the definition, the defining spirit of mood of a particular period of history as shown by the ideas and beliefs of the time. For example, the story captured the zeitgeist of the late 1960s. So there's an approach that a composer cannot help relating also to what is happening musically and within the society history. Well, so there are some works that really depict history or try to depict history. Not a translation, we've seen that music is most abstract, but somehow are linked to historical, sociological processes that cannot be ignored. But the zeitgeist also, meaning a collective, a sort of shared knowledge of the state of the art, of music, of what the gusto or the style has reached at that particular time of history, that is also most fitting in our case. That applies to what we're trying to define as style and why style cannot be entirely subjective. So the saying, beauty is in the eyes of the beholder, cannot be applied to music, to art and culture entirely. We should say perhaps that the appreciation of beauty or recognition of beauty in our case is something that has to do with understanding more than anything else. Understanding of that creation of humankind in its own right. One example, this I should say is a rather easy way to appreciate and recognize changes of style in music. We take one piece, one theme from Paganini's famous 24 Capricci for violin. And this 24th Capriccio was actually written in this type of form. We have not talked about it in detail. Theme and variations. It is a form. It is a genre also. So there is a theme. We have seen that a theme has a pretty defined structure. In this case, when the theme serves as base for the development of variations, it tends to have a more extended form than the classical theme, eight-bar theme, eight-measure theme. Sometimes it is really a small ternary form or a binary form, as in this case, but it's important to recognize this short piece of music that is used, manipulated in other subsequent short pieces of music that we call variations. So here is the famous Capriccio by Paganini. Let's hear what it sounds like. Variation one. So the theme, the bass is there. It changes the surface level. And more variations. Okay, there is a very famous transcription by Franz Liszt, which touches and manipulates the style ever so slightly or more deeply. Now, quite a few years later, Johannes Brahms, in the year 1863, and we just say rather late in the 19th century, still using high romantic style with hints of modernism, as we will see in a future lecture, as they have been discovered and promoted by Schoenberg, Brahms the progressive, not so much of a conservative, in fact. But what we see here is this tendency really going further, pushing piano writing further away from tradition, even though the harmonic tradition seems to be, at the beginning, in the first variations, rather conservative. So the theme is pretty much untouched, unaffected, a transcription of the piano. And then you have double. Okay. The tuba is rather original, actually, very heavy. Then the next variation, really very interesting, sounds somewhat it's like violin music. But it is actually piano. What now? More and more original. And this, three against the rules, blurring two notes at a time, creating a rather fast harmonic rhythm without changing the functions, just by use of dancing. Typical of Brahms. That's his style. Well, this is a very, very important, very famous masterpiece by Brahms. And if we turn to another romantic composer, so we call him romantic, late romantic, post-romantic, well, certainly this is really against, we could even say sometimes hyper-romanticism, that wouldn't be entirely accurate, because Rachmaninoff, in as much as it may seem fully fair, towards a clear rejection mentality, variation by habits, especially when they amuse themselves treatment of very famous things. This is a way, I think, of recording the play of the style of a given company. Now, dominant, but it is very interesting that more and more adventurous, more and more adventurous. And finally, in the background of the moment, I and this beautiful moment of suspension. What a dominant. What a chord is, it sounds almost like a jazz. What is that? There's a seventh, there's an 11th. And now, oh, right, because it is the sequence. It sounded as if he were modulating towards me. Alternative to the September. Just this, rather modern. Well, it couldn't be Brahms, absolutely. So only a few years later, Lutoslawski came up with these inventions on the same theme. The theme, same thing. Oops. It has been manipulated. Well, should we say it is a more modern approach? Is it more 20th century than Rachmaninoff? That's where the judgment of time and style and zeitgeist plays an important role. Those numbers that we see, 1941, are in a way part of the composition We're not judging composition just by the pure curationary. There's always an element of stylistic judgment, evaluation. This is no longer romantic. Dissonances are no longer passive dissonances, but are color dissonances that become consonances in their own right. This is the fascination of style, how everything unfolds in a way that we should really say some composers interpret more than others, not only the zeitgeist, but also perhaps what, why not, musical criticism demands or criticizes rather than demands, or simply like Rachmaninoff, their phenomenal command of the musical language allows him to write in a style that to us sounds like, and perhaps it is, the continuation of mature Chopin, Fourth Ballade or Barcarolle, for example. It moves forward. The development doesn't stop. So Romanticism has still much to offer. And we have a composer, pianist, living in the same years as other composers, and we'll see that they somehow, at some point, had to change music history, breaking through the borders of harmony and sometimes also of form. What is a musical image? Can we say that music can actually convey images, concrete images, like we can recognize concrete images? No. At its best, and sometimes at its worst, music can attempt at metaphors of concrete images, metaphors of what we somehow, what we carry with in our experience and in our memory, memory of experience also. But a realistic, a totally realistic music that really interprets like a photocopy, an image, and has that purpose. Well, there have been some attempts. It's called concrete music, and we'll hear some examples which this music, yes, reutilizes actual sounds from the environment, from the world, real sounds, not produced by an artist, but if anything, reassembled by an artist. So art as such exists whenever there is an interaction that goes way beyond the sensorial experience. We should say that every moment of experience has an artistic side to it. To have an exact photocopy of reality is impossible, but in some cases, a photocopy of reality is just exactly what we want. Not in art, not in music, impossible, not even in visual arts. The development, I said, evolution in that sense of fittest, not best, the evolution of visual depiction of reality follows a certain path that we can easily recognize. It seems to somehow get to a focus point in which what we see is rather close to reality. Nothing in terms of realism is really missing except that photocopy effect, which not even hyperrealism is able to achieve, because the photocopy effect of reality cloning reality is really just reliving it. And even if we relive it will always be different to us. Giotto, what's missing? Can we say something is missing, Giotto? When we watch, we must take into account when it was produced, where and when it was produced, what Giotto was achieving with that so-called, we use it, perhaps a bit not quite properly, state of the art, the state of the art, the state of knowledge, understanding of perspective, image, reproduction of image, in those times was such that we can say that Giotto has achieved miracles, and also the meaningfulness of images and of the subjects, what they're trying to express in those times was really a breakthrough. It is far from being a photocopy of reality, of course. Art tends to, in history, tends to get closer and closer to a photocopy of reality. And here we have a more realistic sense of perspective, perhaps. And again, we have to take into account that this work of art was realized in the dates that you can see in the slide, that time and place. That affects everything, the perception of colors, the meaning of colors, the symbolic meaning of colors, the various layers of judgment of a work of art. It is place, very important, the symbols, what it was trying to convey, the meanings, the subjects. Here, many people think that this painter has reached really a very high degree of technically realistic reproduction of reality. Well, of course, as I said, which artist would want to just make a photocopy? Photocopies did not exist at that time. A bland, technically correct photocopy of reality. But visual art seems to have this path. It gets closer and closer to, let's say, a realistic representation of the world, and then seems to depart from it as we move on in the history of art. Now, the question is it departing from something or is it approaching something else? So is this, compared to this, a more blurred representation of reality, or rather a more subjective? Is the watcher and the artist more important in their representation, their fruition and creation of the imagery that we now, of which we now are the watchers? And the fruition, the contemporary fruition, is again something that is affected by our past experiences. But now we are thinking also more of how the subject is rather a mixture, a collaborative mixture of subjects. The one experiencing the subject in creating it, and the subject, the reality that we have not seen, the artist has seen, perceived, developed, elaborated, like those variations on the same theme, like Brahms has done, Rachmaninoff has done, Lutoslawski has done. So where is art going now? Is it departing from the exact reproduction of reality? We still recognize shapes. We still recognize a figure. And now, where is the figure? Is this farther away from reality? No. As long as there is a subject, there is the subject's phenomenology of the experienced reality, or the imagined reality, or the non-imagined reality. So we have to ask ourselves, has the evolution of music followed a similar pathways? Has it gone towards a rather realistic representation of what we recognize as, okay, this is recognizable as reality, or we find it rather recognizable? There is no discomfort, no unsettling elements in this recognizability of our own imagined musical reality, for example. Let's see. We've heard all this in the previous lecture. there is a development of, let's say, of styles that also follows the development of use of dissonances. We've seen that. Or the consonances and dissonances of the speech, and somehow also connected that type of pattern instead of it. It's different from this. Quite different, not totally different. We still recognize something else rather realistic, it makes sense to us. We've heard this, Bach's vocal consonants. And here is the evolution of music. Now, some dissonances sound less dissonant. They sound necessary. Especially in instrumental music, which is even more complex. As we listen to this speech, we should really, rather than trying to attempt a logical or aesthetic comparison with Baroque painters, whose realism was extraordinary, we should really ask ourselves, as non-musicians, as non-music people, what do we really appreciate? This is perhaps something that is more immediate, that speaks to us more easily. Musicians consider this music really the canon. Focus. And no musician believes that this music can get any better. So the evolution, why did it occur? Why did composers do differently after Bach? Well, in his life, Bach was not that influential as we imagine he should have been. Also, in those times, there were audiences that needed to expand, needed something more recognizable, a style that was, let's say, clearer in its elements, melody, harmony, the symmetry of structure. By this, we don't mean simpler. But there has been a moment in which, a period in history in which we, in retrospect, we think, oh, music got a bit simplified to fit the general taste. Well, this composer certainly achieved the utmost, the best. And this is another important canon of Western music. Achieved clarity without stooping down to simplicity. Clarity. Such a clarity we can really say with this music, less is more. It has become really a model of perfection, formal perfection also. Basically, have you heard? Now. Very clear. And we know that it's also very logical in logic, argumentation logic. We will never put the consequent before the antecedent, and affirming the consequent is a well-known logical fallacy. So next, the development, the critical development of music. We've heard this, how this starts in a very provocative way and unfolds many ways. And we think, because of this, these contrasts, the contrast, we start thinking of a style that moves. But now we are speaking about aesthetics of music, not that grammar that defines a style as such. Oh, it would take hundreds of lectures. In fact, when a music student studies theory and composition, well, it takes them years and years, 10 years, 15 years, sometimes less, sometimes more, not even to master past styles, but just to apply their grammar in a more, let's say, in a sufficiently competent way. It takes many, 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 many years of technical work, understanding the styles. And one can never really, hardly, I would say, never say never, but it's really a very far-fetched conclusion to dare say that one can reach a state of the art of that year, of that time. One would have to really live many lives. And we've heard this, we have a style here that is somewhat rather, let's say, recognizable as realistic, as clear, appealing, even to the non-musician. It is a melody, simple accompaniment. The beauty of this melody is its name. Such also thanks to those dissonances that bring inner movement of the music, color, dialectics. And we chose this piece because it is remarkably similar to this. Now, who would fail to say that this piece is beautiful? Anyone that hears the first notes and they would say, how beautiful. Why? And why isn't this piece ugly? Look at the dates of composition. Imagine these dates not having an 18 as the first two numbers, but 19. Well, those are the years. Rachmaninoff, pretty much, he had composed the fourth concerto, but it was the years of his Rhapsody that we've heard. No, had somebody written this piece 100 years later, what would we say? Oh, where is the zeitgeist? Where is the state of the art? Why are you ignoring what's happened to music in those 100 years that you are denying? So the judgment can be twofold. The expert aesthetic judgment saying, state of the art zeitgeist, you're killing them, and reproduces something that you have the right to do only for your own satisfaction, but cannot pretend, cannot expect to have its own place in music history, in the development of music history. That is one judgment. The other judgment is just fruition, irrespective of those two elements, zeitgeist and state of the art. I hear this, I listen to it, I like it or I don't like it. And as I said, since we cannot apply this sentence, the beauty is in the eyes of the beholder, we cannot be certain that anyone whose taste has been affected by historicism would say, this is as beautiful as it would have been had it been written 100 years before. So had it been written, for example, 50 years ago, it would have had a completely different meaning. In this case, the less irreverent attempt is manipulating a piece with purpose. And we've heard this. Playing a trick, imagining, written by Chopin himself 100 years later. This very skillful recomposition. And this musical trick, musical joke, a lot about how society changes, but not, it is not, there is no pretentious demonstrating how Chopin should have been. And we've heard, of course, that famous dissonant chord of the first ballad, 1835. Let's put a 7 as the second number. 1735. What is this? Well, first of all, oh, the piano didn't have this sound. It's very interesting. But where is the shape? Where is the form? Where is the architecture of the theme? The fantasy style. Look at this chord. What is this chord? Sounds implausible. Although some people, especially Domenico Scarlatti, did venture in rather adventurous harmonic territories. Now let's listen to this. 1857-59. Shall we change the dates again? Doesn't change much. 1657? No way. 1757? Well, we should really study the history of the melodrama of opera. Novel. But what if it had been written in 19? Well, there is a new edition of Wagnerism. Purist, that would be justified on ideological grounds. There must be a difference. There's such a thing as neo-romanticism. Let's say we are moving now away from that very basic, recognizable music, that Mozart theme. And for the layman, with all due respect, for the either non-educated or non-connoisseur music listener, this is a bit too much. Doesn't really make sense. Unless there is a willful approach and intention that trying to understand this music, let's say again, on its own terms, what it really means within its own system, linguistic system. and we have Ravel, that seems to play interesting tricks on us, with all its modernity, seems to really sound beautiful. Playing words that are always this consonant in their own right. Of course, now play this to any person who has no sensory sound. It's not. It is really the product of a very refined mind, very refined approach that unifying and reorganizing. Before we review important aspects of historicism, we should ask ourselves this question. How has music steered clear of the most recognizable aspects useful to an immediate fruition of itself, fruition of a piece of melody, of our song, a beautiful piece? Why, how has music developed its own complexity or lack of complexity, recognizability of melody or lack thereof? Why has it done? Has it somehow, was it a departure from reality? Was it the way we have seen in visual arts, but that same departure from the reality is only apparent, because is it not the reality as in a photocopy, but rather an experienced reality, experienced life that answers to the demands, necessity of the artist and their representation of life experience, the way every object has a very tight, complex connection and interaction with the subject. Nobody can escape from his own time to take a position outside of history. Look at that. This judgment is huge, has a huge weight on everything that we've heard so far in this lecture. Every piece is judged according also to its position in history. So the few years apart between Lutoslavsky and Rachmaninoff, and mind you, there are also years apart from Lutoslavsky and Schoenberg and Stravinsky and Webern, and we could judge also Lutoslavsky of where is the zeitgeist, where is the second Viennese school. The way we think, the way we are, has shaped our history, our culture. Does every artist in music have to do that in order to create beautiful pieces of music? Well, there's another important motto. Whenever the cause A happens, the effect B will happen afterwards. So these aspects of historicism that we apply to the development and changes of society, many people, scholars, composers, they have wanted to find also in the development of music, some perhaps naively expected that music could have such a big impact on reality. The other way around, could actually change, shape the world, because music could provide some examples for its existence and teach us how to shape an ideal world, an ideal society, which is ideal for some, but not for others. Historicism is very important in classical music. So a classical musician finds that it's difficult to reply to questions like, do you like this piece? Well, classical musician will want to know, always when this piece was written. And we should wonder, well, why? Can't you just listen to it and enjoy? No, we have to keep this in mind. Every stage of history is a logical development of the previous stage. Logical in every way. But I said before that Bach had not yet become so influential to shape history. Yes, but the circumstances imposed those changes. So if we do not believe in what Hegel says, history as something that is unstoppable, a sort of destiny, we can at least take into account circumstances of history. The famous Frankfurt Sociological School has also, Creed has also given us ideologies, and but also, I should say, something that we should not ignore. Adorno, again, the weight of Adorno, I'm speaking from a very personal standpoint, can be overemphasized when we feel always guilty, when we appreciate beauty without thinking of beauty in its function in history and society. But can we deny this? This sentence is very famous, and it seems that later he sort of reassessed it because of one word, barbaric. But can we write poetry? Can we appreciate beauty? Can we say it's beautiful after Auschwitz, which was a result of human creativity, and also, we should say, of a part of the world that had given an important legacy of intelligence, profundity, and artistry. If each one of us is at risk of producing such barbaric effects, can we now be so optimistic and forget it and write poetry? So this, to write poetry, we could translate to write a beautiful piece without sarcasm. A beautiful piece is somewhat inappropriate if that is the result of ignoring where history has brought us, what it has to teach. This corrodes even the knowledge of why it has become impossible to write poetry today. So for modern composers, Adorno, who himself was a trained musician, Adorno has been influential in two main ways. Not only the importance we have to attach to the function, the social function, historical function of music, but also to look at music as art in itself, independent from commercial interests, independent also from ignorance, with the non-ability of appreciating music. Because if beauty is entirely in the eye of the beholder, quality entirely in the appreciation of the watcher or listener, then all its development, all the responsibility and the profession and hard work of musicians is gone because it is not readily appreciated. So it is, I should say, it is an important statement, but it is also important to notice that many victims of those barbaric acts have not reacted without writing poetry, but if anything, continuing to write poetry and believing in poetry and in beauty. So the reaction to ugliness can actually be pure beauty, and not feeling always guilty towards history and the zeitgeists. I put an S, an English S, because music has its own aims. It has to touch, it has to convey meanings, as I said, on musical terms. In this timeline, let's imagine at the center of the timeline, a moment in which music doesn't sound to us strange. Well, these are composers we've heard in these lectures. Well, forgive me, Maestro Schoenberg, Maestro Adolf, Ravel, Strauss, and one of them is still alive. If I call them strange, I'm not strange. The music doesn't fit, perhaps, that melody than anyone from the street would say, oh, how beautiful, oh, how cute. Or perhaps he would. Neither does perhaps Palestrina, whose music, the music of angels, is purely beautiful music. We should say, no, it doesn't really, cannot entirely fit the taste of just anyone. Neither can Bach. No, I should not say that would sound very snobbish and arrogant because it is too good, but because it is really the result of a complex grammar, a complex system of laws, of procedures, of understanding of work. The actual aim was not immediate appreciation. The real artist doesn't go for that. Same thing, similar in the timeline. At the center of the timeline, we should say, okay, we've reached a moment of appreciation in which they are aligned. What I expect, I get, pretty much. Everything that is before or that is after Caravaggio is not so realistic. What is it? It's artistic. Good. We have to wonder now, has music really had the same pathway? That is, a departure from reality or just the opposite? We think music, yes, like arts, it gets less and less recognizable. Does it mean that it's now really as far from reality as it can be? That's what logically, why we would think music is now remote from reality, right? Wrong. There is no reality in music. There is no single object of reality that music can even try to depict. It's all at its best, metaphors perhaps. So when music, even avant-garde music, moves away from what we have called music, understandable, it's actually opposite. It seems to reach a state of sound architecture that is closer, if anything, to what we experience in reality. See, if we can say that the visual organization of reality has a lot of sense, must have a lot of sense, especially nature. The way nature orders, keeps its own order, is unbelievable, absolutely out of reach for a human being. Yet, the sounds that this produces are not organized, are completely random, except for the sounds of communication. Those are organized when the bird calls organized are necessary. When living beings communicate, they do have to organize sounds. But the sounds of nature, as we like, the rattle of spring, the sounds of water, of a river, wind, it responds only to, it answers to a logic, if anything, of so-called chaos mathematics, of a chaotic order, but it is very remote from the way we could imagine really a deliberate order of sounds. And there have been tendencies in music at utilizing the sounds of reality as such, called concrete. Hear this. You go around to the recorder, and then of course, you see it's not entirely out. Because it has to organize. Somebody's playing the piano. Piano doesn't exist in nature. The string instruments. So recomposing is an act of composition. Reorganizing is an act of organization. It's art. And it's probably, paradoxically, closer to a representation of a natural form of sound, this organization. That's a radio. Imagine writing music with radio. Well, it is really now the appreciation of it, the understanding of it is really in the ear. And also music organized sounds, not harmonies, tonic, dominant, themes, motives. There is a certain degree of randomness, so-called aleatory music. But the moment in which someone decides to give the start of this randomness, that's the moment in which the work of art begins to exist. This is a more faithful representation of reality. Not more remote. Music is totally abstract. We cannot expect from music to have something that is really, we call it realistic. And when we hear this, look at the Yerevan script. Well, it could have been worse. But Rachmaninoff, written this piece, 1899, is that eight written in the second half? That's very well. Look at this, is the ideal setting for a sentimental scene. This is the second concerto. Boy, has this scene put a lot of weight on the appreciation, understanding, also judgment of Rachmaninoff's great artist. It's Hollywood. In a detrimental way. This association of Hollywood classical music is always made in a detrimental way. I cannot say that I stand by this approach, aesthetic approach, but here Rachmaninoff took it down to simply
whatever your dream was.
Background.
It wasn't a very happy one, was it?
Soundtrack, sentiment.
Is there anything I
can do? That goes clashes heavily with the aesthetics of historicism. You see, when the movie appeared, look what had happened. 1902, Pelagie et Lazare. 1909, first real atonal work, at least for piano, Busoni. Sonatina Seconda, The Firebird, Stravinsky, 1910, Strauss, The Rosenkavalier, Pierrot Nuner, Schoenberg. Isn't there anything in those works that can represent the anguish of love, separation of unity? Do we need something that really sounds sentimental? Well, here's where sometimes the aesthetic artistic judgment fails us. When something is too recognizably sentimental, romantic, or we say Chopinian even to some extent, but happens in this timeline, we think it's wrong. It's aesthetically wrong. Perhaps the composer didn't know better. I think we, as maybe three postmodern people, we could now leap a bit further and just appreciate, give a little less importance to the zeitgeist, except for the necessity of keeping in mind that what happens around us, we artists should not ignore, do not want to ignore. We're not satisfied with beauty as a parenthesis on the beauty. If anything, if we cannot represent reality, it can at least fight against it when we don't like that reality. So what we heard of Rachmaninoff compared to those other works is more in tune, it's more aligned to this. To what we find rather realistic and of easy fruition, so-called sometimes easy listening. So, that nocturne by Chopin, played by Rubinstein. When Rubinstein plays that first note, that B flat, we must recognize this and remember always, always, that note belongs to this inverted pyramid. It belongs to a group, phraseological group, a meter, a rhythm, which belongs to a section, which belongs to a form. It's not entirely independent. Belongs to an instrumental setting for which instruments it has been devised, composed. To a genre, what is it? A sonata, a waltz, theme and variations? To the language of the composer, was it Bach? To the composer, the composer had an education, specific education, in an artistic domain, music, in a place, in a time, and ultimately in the history of music and of humanity. When we musicians, we classical musicians, listen to music, we place every note at the bottom of this pyramid. So it is not enough for us to just appreciate that note, or even that group or section, form, instrument, genre, language. Sometimes we start from history. Where, when, and why? It is a complex of parameters that make music, classical music, in fact, classical. Just these two notes belong to all that. So if we appreciate this, is a very, it's interesting, this video, a blind test to recognize the pieces. Is it in the inverted order of popularity? Well, you can go at random. What is it? When was it? How is it? Romantic? Harmony, harmonic rhythm, so we appreciate it because it was written at that time, and at that time, a bit more romantic, and it's played more lush. Very beginning. I think it's very representative, very realistic. And that falls to me. Oh, it seems to take time to develop, but it's there. It's an opera. Opera is a sort of like it's Russian. Very recognizable, not too. Well, Wagner would have used also brass, but okay. Very clear. Less is more. Okay. You can go on and I suggest you. You have fun. Listen to this or other videos, other collections. And try to detect. There are some parameters. our themes are playing. Have randomized, no or motive, or sort of randomized, or sound randomized. If they're very clear, kaleidoscopic, they're very clear, so randomized. Okay? Not meant to be randomized. Okay. So, imagine this piece, written in the 1820s by Beethoven. Said, oh, wow, he really was transcending his time. But for Davis's time, it actually sounds a little old-fashioned, little romantic, but of course, here is the classical drama. Repetitive accompaniment. Very good. Very proud and beautiful. Members. Some people call it classical romantic, romantic. Biedermeier. So the perception of style we have seen takes into account always time and zeitgeist. The same genre, subject, similar subject, can be treated like the same variation, of course, in different ways according to the time, to the composer or painter, artist. And again, watching the way artists treat the same subject is one interesting tool or hint at understanding the aesthetics and the language of such artists. Landscaping. Until we reach something that is rather implausible. Or, in this case, that many people, according also to what the author left us in writing, many people believe it is very musical. Why? Well, as I said before, something that is abstract in visual arts, it's not the same in music. In music, everything is abstract because a melody is not found in the garden outside. You don't find a rhythm on the street. You don't meet the harmony. It doesn't rain. Harmonies don't rain. Melodies, see, the wind doesn't carry melodies. Yes, it does. It carries sounds, but it is really something that has been construed and harmonized, developed musically. So let's try to guess, why is this painting musical? Because like a musical, those lines, well, he wrote an important big essays on line, point and surface, Kandinsky. Well, those lines, the way they interact with each other, those shapes, are pretty much those recognizable elements in music that make up a musical structure and how it unfolds in time. And he said, the more abstract the form, the more clear and direct its appeal. So it is not distracted by a more easily, too easily consequential reality, but of the reality that lives within the mind, fantasy experience, and also painful experience of the artist. Curiously, two Russians have associated colors to music so powerfully. Not only Kandinsky, whose dark blue was for him the double basis of an orchestra, but Scriabin. Scriabin also applied this synesthesia to music. Very interesting. But again, the border perception between the two domains is rather strong. In all associations that have been attempted between visual arts and music, have that very thick border, that limit in which the human methodological, illogical, fantastic ability that we have to create metaphors and also invest our experience make it a very, very interesting world. We can go back to our blind test and enjoy what else it has to offer, and perhaps, is this more sentimental? Yes. Thank God it was hadn't been written essentially. Why, thank God. Do we need to know? It is spontaneous. Yes, we do need to know. Perhaps one day we will not need to know, but we'll realize that there is something very solid about composers' right, according to the way the master, they master state of the art. It's very much according to their own ability. So this is the end and the beginning of a musical appreciation based on musicals, based on music's demands, music's grammar, based on music on its own terms. And we can consider a fourfold introduction. Is there a meaning in music? Yes, but it is a musical meaning. Well, it's a tautology, we know that. And what is a theme? What makes a theme? Well, the theme is somewhat recognizable. It could be a motive. It's made of motives. It has a structure. And we need also a form. There are many types of forms and styles that allows us to understand, appreciate, and say, okay, I like this piece because... Or perhaps even if I do not like this piece, because I will listen to it very attentively and try to learn how this fascinating abstract world of sounds is organized and is given to us even for free. We don't need any special technique, any special technology. We need very little. Or we can make the small investment of going to a concert. Next series of lectures will focus more in detail on those aspects of musical composition without demanding from the watcher and the listener to be a skilled or educated musician. Yes, knowing how to read music helps. And that is also one of the difficulties in appreciation of music. But we will do our best to provide this understanding of music, as I say, on its own terms. Thank you.